supplement timing and food combining for zinc. Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Okay, Adam Stern also says, can you please give me a little more color on timing of taking zinc supplements as it relates to the COVID protocol, i.e. how long before or after can you take zinc if you eat any of the foods that you should not eat it with, like wheat and nuts? And is coffee on that list? Not sure how this affects the ability for the body to absorb. Also, can you explain the advantage or disadvantage of taking pill versus lozenge for your, all your zinc intake? Finally, any thoughts on kids taking zinc for the protocol, minor 11, 14, and 15? So for zinc and food, the main issue is that my guess is that a carnivore meat-based meal would probably enhance zinc absorption, but that's never really been tested. And so most meals contain some phytate, and there is some indication that zinc is better absorbed on an empty stomach. And so there's some controversy in the field over whether you should take zinc on an empty stomach or just with a phytate-free meal. So my position is basically like, if it's practical for you to take the zinc on an empty stomach, do an empty stomach. And if it's not practical for you to take the zinc on an empty stomach, do it on a phytate-free meal. And so a phytate-free meal would be no whole grains, nuts, seeds, or legumes. I think that if it's practical for you, it would be best to consider an empty stomach 3 hours after the last time you ate, 1 hour before the next time you eat. So if you eat every 4 hours, taking the zinc at the 3 hour mark would fulfill that criteria. And if that is not practical for you, I would take it at least 40 minutes after the last time you ate and at least 40 minutes before the next time you ate. But if you can't at least meet that minimum, and that's the minimum, that's not the ideal, but if you can't at least meet that minimum, then don't focus on the timing. Focus on the phytate-free meal. So take your zinc with a meal that has no whole grains, nuts, seeds, or legumes. Now, the problem becomes if you're in the high-risk version of the COVID protocol and you are trying to really maximize your systemic supply of zinc, you are really taking that zinc 4 times a day. And if you are taking it with 4 phytate-free meals, that means that you are now on a phytate-free diet. So if you don't want to be on a diet that has no whole grains, nuts, seeds, and legumes, you really should try to meet the timing requirements for taking zinc away from the meals. But you can mix and match them, right? So if you eat one phytate-free meal, then you can take one of the doses of zinc with that. But in the other 2 or 3 meals, you focus more on the timing, trying to take the zinc on an empty stomach. Unfortunately, coffee is a zinc inhibitor, and so you really should take the zinc away from the coffee. In terms of pills versus lozenges, the pills are great for supplying the zinc systemically. The lozenges are great for supplying the zinc to the nose and throat. Presumably in an early illness with COVID or common cold, for common cold, you're all in the nose and throat. For COVID, you are probably in the early stages. You caught it in the nose and throat, and it took longer to really start messing with the lower respiratory tract. I think from a preventative standpoint, or actually I think from a preventative nutritional standpoint, you're trying to maximize nutritional zinc, systemic zinc. So you're focusing on capsules or foods. But you also, if you believe you're going into high-risk situations, you also want to make sure that your nose and throat are sort of up to par, where if they're the first to be slammed with a viral insult, you know that their zinc concentrations are very good. And so that's why in the protocol I also say that in high-risk situations before and after potential exposures, use a zinc lozenge. Now, the zinc lozenges, zinc acetate is best for getting zinc into the nose and throat. If it gets into the nose and throat, that means it doesn't get into the rest of the body. Hold on one second. If it gets in the nose and throat, it's not really getting to the rest of the body. And so I don't know what proportion of the zinc acetate lozenge gets into the nose and throat rather than the rest of the body. But I do know that if you're using something like zinc gluconate, that probably half as much is getting into the nose and throat. And so, you know, you're getting a lot more to the rest of the body. But since I don't really know the mix, my general approach would be use zinc acetate lozenges to get into the nose and throat, use capsules to get into the rest of the body. And so I think if you have become ill and you're sneezing and you have a sore throat and you're coughing, you really know that at that point you want to pound the zinc into the upper respiratory tract. But I don't think that that means that you don't want to keep getting zinc systemically. You do, especially because there are many other tissues that are vulnerable to COVID. So if you look at the treatment, the four case reports with the treatment with zinc lozenges, they just use only zinc lozenges. But if you look at the COVID protocol, you have a mix of both. And so I think that mix of both in the COVID protocol is basically designed to make sure that, yes, once your nose and throat have been assaulted, you're flooding them with maximal zinc, but you still aren't neglecting to make sure that you get zinc systemically because you're not inhaling the zinc, so it's not really getting into your lungs. And, you know, SARS-CoV-2 infects has the possibility of infecting many other organs, so you don't want to only get the zinc there. Even though, you know, presumably if it just got into your nose and you get rid of it, it's not going to spread, right? So that is the top priority. I just don't think it makes sense for it to be the only priority under any context. And hence mixing the two approaches. For kids, it says it at the top of the protocol I would just take the dose and assume that dose is for a 2,000 calorie diet, and then modify it by using the kid's caloric intake. And so, simple formula to do that would be divide the dose by 2,000 and then multiply it by the number of calories the kid eats per day. I think that's the simple way to do it. And I'm not suggesting that everyone should be adjusting it by calories. I'm just, you know, I think for adults, just use the standard dosing. But for kids, just if you're concerned about, you know, overshooting the kid's nutritional tolerance for that thing because they're small, I would do it based on food intake in that way. Thank you, Adam, for your questions.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount. For the remainder of 2020, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.